In this video, we're analyzing a three-part Atwood machine. So we have two hanging masses off the left and right sides of a tabletop, and those are connected by strings to a mass that slides along the tabletop, feeling kinetic friction as it slides. And the way this problem is set up, we're asked to use the energy approach to the problem. So we're going to look at potential energies and work and a final kinetic energy. And then the goal is to find the final speed of the system after it's moved through a displacement of 45 centimeters. So just to quickly summarize what's going on with energies in this problem, the hanging mass on the left, I called that one M1, is going to experience an increase in gravitational potential energy. The hanging mass on the right is falling downward because that's the heavier mass. That's why the system is evolving in that direction. So that mass, which I called M2, is going to experience a decrease in gravitational potential energy. And then we don't consider the gravitational potential energy of the sliding mass at all because its height is staying the same the entire time. There is no change in gravitational potential energy there. We don't have to worry about that. But there is a friction force pointing to the left as the mass slides to the right. And that friction force is going to do negative work on the system. When we get to the final state, after everything is moved by 45 centimeters, all three of these masses are moving with a common final velocity because they're connected by strings. So we get a kinetic energy contribution from every one of these masses, and they all share that same final velocity. So once we get our statement of energy conservation set up, the only unknown is going to be that final velocity, and we should be able to solve the problem. So just to start with a general statement of energy conservation here, we have E initial plus any work done by non-conservative forces. So I'm going to call that W sub NC. That's going to be equal to E final. Now, qualitatively, what happens here is friction does negative work with that non-conservative work term, and it reduces the total amount of energy in the system, so the final energy is less than the initial. And then we're going to think about all the relevant sources of energy in the initial and final state for each of these three masses. And we'll start by looking at M1, and we just have to be clear about what's the y-coordinate system that we're going to use for analyzing the gravitational potential energy there. And I'm going to go ahead and call the initial y-value, so I'm going to call that y1 initial. I'm going to call that 0, so that's the lowest point for that mass. And then I have this final value, y1 final, is equal to 0.45 meters, just switching into meters there. Now we do a similar thing for M2. And for M2, I'm going to go ahead and call the lowest point for that guy 0. So I'm going to say y2 final is equal to 0. And that means its initial height, so y2 initial, is going to be 0.45 meters. So those y coordinates will allow us to keep track of the initial and final gravitational potential energy terms for those two hanging masses. And now we look at the sliding mass. So this sliding mass experiences a friction force to the left, but remember that's mediated by the normal force. So we need to figure out what's going on in the vertical direction first. So in the vertical direction, we have gravity pulling down on this mass, and I'll just leave that symbolic for now. That has a magnitude of m3 times g. And the normal force pushes up on this mass, and the normal force is always doing whatever it has to cause the perpendicular forces to sum to zero. Since nothing else is going on in the vertical direction, that's simply m3g pointing up. Now we'll go ahead and put the friction force into the picture, and we'll just label that as fk for now, standing for kinetic friction, and we could write that as mu k times the normal force. So as that block slides to the right along the tabletop with a friction force pointing to the left, we're going to get a negative work done by friction that reduces the total energy in the system. All right, so now we can get back to our statement of energy conservation and ask, what are all the initial sources of energy? Note that there's no change in gravitational potential energy for the sliding mass. So we've implicitly just said the y-coordinate there is zero the whole time. We don't have to worry about those terms for the sliding mass. So my initial mechanical energy is contained entirely in the mass M2 because that has a non-zero initial gravitational potential energy. Notice that the initial gravitational potential energy is zero for M1, and then we're basically just ignoring gravitational potential energies for M3. So we end up with a term that looks like m2g times y2 initial. And then we need to get the work done by friction in there. So that's going to be negative, and that's because the friction force points opposite to the displacement vector. And the friction force has a magnitude of mu k times the normal force, which was m3g. And then we have to multiply by the displacement, which I'll just call d. All right, then in my final state, M1 now has a positive gravitational potential energy, and M2 has a gravitational potential energy of zero. So let's get M1's gravitational potential energy in there. That's M1G Y1 final. And then the only remaining energy in the system is the kinetic energy of all three of these masses moving along with the same final velocity. So we can wrap that all in a single kinetic energy term, 1/2 times the total mass. So that's M1 plus M2 plus M3 times this unknown V final squared. So at this point, we'll go ahead and plug numbers in. M2 is 3.1 kilograms. G, we're going to use the approximation 9.8. Y2 initial, 0.45. Our friction coefficient was 0.2. M3 is 1.5 kilograms. Again, G is about 9.8 meters per second squared. And then our displacement D is 0.45 meters. So there's the left side of the equation. And then on the right, we have M1, which is 2.7 kilograms. G is 9.8. Y1 final, 0.45 meters. Plus 1/2 times the sum of all three of these masses times our unknown final velocity squared. Now, when I'm handling a calculation like this, I normally do it all at once in my calculator. So I'll try to describe sort of the sequence of steps that you have to take. What I would start with is just simplifying the left-hand side here. So we take these two products and subtract them. Then we subtract from that this product, 2.7 times 9.8 times 0.45. That would leave us only with the kinetic energy term on the right-hand side. So then we multiply both sides by 2, and then divide by this total mass, and then square root the result. And when you do all this in your calculator, you end up with a final velocity of 0.348 meters per second. And it's probably nicer to express this in centimeters per second as 34.8 centimeters per second, and we're done. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.